I want to introduce our speaker tonight. Most people know him as the husband of Carol Coleman. But it actually turns out he has an amazing resume himself. So Don is a professor of marine technology at Santa Barbara City College, where he has been training professional commercial divers for 30 years. He began his diving career as a diver, submarine pilot, and ROV, an ROV technician for international underwater contractors in New York. He served as general manager of their Pacific division here in Ventura, and in 1982, he set a depth record diving 1,972 feet, operating an atmospheric diving suit in support of offshore exploration off the Gulf of Mexico. His work has taken him on diving projects all over the world in support of marine research, offshore oil and gas operations, and film projects for many organizations, including National Geographic Society. And he recently trained divers for each of SeaWorld's parks in the use of commercial surface supply diving equipment. Professionally, he serves on the board of directors of the Association of Commercial Diving Educators and the Technical Diving Advisory Board for the National Association of Underwater Instructors. And locally, he serves on the board at the wonderful Santa Barbara Maritime Museum. He's actually our board vice president. And Stop Oil Seeps, California. He's also past president of the Historical Diving Society, USA. He received his associate degree in underwater technology from Florida Institute of Technology and completed his undergraduate work in occupational studies at Cal State Long Beach. And he earned a graduate degree in educational technology at Pepperdine. Don was the director of Santa City College's highly acclaimed marine technology program from 1994 to 2003, after which he returned as a full-time teaching professor. And in 2007, his peers selected him as City College's 29th faculty lecturer, SBC's highest honor. He lives here in Santa Barbara with his wife, Carol, on the Mesa there, and he has two adult children, Robbie, and his daughter, Dee Dee, who is here tonight. Please welcome Don Barkham.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Greg. The roots of deep water commercial diving are firmly embedded right here in Santa Barbara. Tonight we're going to explore a little about those roots. I put together a presentation for you, which actually I've put together over the years from my work at City College, but I've recently included some interviews with some individuals who unfortunately are no longer with us. So my discipline at City College has a rich history in itself, and it's a big part of those roots in commercial diving. But before I begin, I do want to acknowledge a colleague of mine, Chris Swan, whose 20 years of research resulted in a seminal piece of published work, The History of Oil Field Diving. And you can see this is the Bible. So everything that I'm talking about here tonight is well documented. You can see my little stickies here. That's a time ago as I was proving this. But more interesting than that is the fact that when I read this text, I really appreciated the amount of research, but then I really appreciated the amount of history that we have here in Santa Barbara. And a book really doesn't tell the story quite like does the real players. And a lot of them are here with us in this room tonight. So I took my video camera and I interviewed several of them, and many of them are not with us here. So these are personal treasures to me, and I'm sure to many of you in the diving industry. So with that, I'll get started. And we start out with our essential question for our talk today. Why is Santa Barbara a hub for diving? And really the answer to that question is embedded in three of our local natural resources. The first of those is abalone. And I know there's many abalone divers here in the audience. Is the master himself, Pat Hamlin, here today? Should be here. I don't want to be here, but maybe he's coming later. I know Bob Kirby is here, an old abalone diver, and we'll be visiting and talking with Bob here as we progress through the evening. But abalone is a single-shelled mollusk which clings to the local rocky reefs. And a lot of people know that abalone is delicious to eat, and they're remember Michael Hutchins came there and actually cooked us about 11 years ago. Quite delicious. The second of those resources is oil. And some people say we can't live with it, but we certainly can't live without it. Modern society is oil reliant, we all know that, and it's been a part of Santa Barbara's culture for many thousands of years. And the third of those natural resources that helps us answer our question is probably our most appreciated resource, Santa Barbara Channel Islands. And we all love the Channel Islands playing it all back in our here, the map behind the screen. So it's quite a bit about that. Now, as I began to prepare for my talk, I was researching into alimony, and I had me backpedaling all the way back to the Chumash period. And I paid a visit to one of our local resources here, our local treasures, the Santa Barbara Museum of Natural History. And there I talked with the curator of anthropology, Dr. John Johnson, and he provided some great insight into the early use of our three natural resources, abalone, oil, and the Channel Islands.
We can tell that abalone has been used here for many thousands of years. There was a wide variety of things that were made from the abalone shells. First of all, the whole shells themselves were used as dishes. And sometimes they would plug up the holes in the edge of the shell with tar, you know, so that it would hold water. The shell was also used to make fish hooks. And you find lots of abalone fish hooks in the Chumash region and on the Channel Islands. 11,000 years ago or so, people are using marine resources. They're harvesting abalone, they're harvesting some of the other shellfish from around the shore. And they continue to do so all down to the time that Europeans arrived. They realized it was a valuable trade item. And so there's a whole variety of ornaments that were used by Chumash Indians and both as necklaces and also regalia.
Now, research in 1986 done by a UCSB scientist, Kennedy, suggests that the Chumash were actually the first to dine abalone in Santa Barbara. And he discovered this by the presence of exoscoces in the external ear canal of some of the skulls that he had uncovered in Chumash burial sites. Now, exoscoces, some of you surfers in the audience are probably familiar with these, it's a bony growth of the ear canal, and it happens due to prolonged immersion in cold water, or frequent immersion in cold water. And he discovered this, so he surmised that they were the first to dive for abalone. Now, when they free-dove for abalone, they used the ribs from whale bones as the abalone iron. So the original abalone iron was a whalebone. And it would pry that up off the rocks to get the abalone. And as John talked about, they used the shells as dishes, and they plugged the holes up with the oil and the tar from the natural oil seeps, which were happening back 8,000 years ago. So for many thousands of years, man has utilized these three natural resources that we mentioned earlier. Now, moving ahead in time, the Japanese introduced compressed air diving to the California abalone fishery back in 1898, right around the turn of the century. They were the pioneers that brought compressed air diving over here to the fishery. So I asked my good friend and dive buddy, Scrap Lundy, to tell us a bit about that era. Scrap passed away last summer. He was a very good friend. I miss him a lot. He was frequent visitor here to the museum, frequent volunteer. But Scrap was the reigning expert on the California abalone industry, and he actually published a book on the subject. Many of you have seen that book.
Well, historically, the Japanese started heavy gear diving for abalone in 1898, and they brought it from Japan, where they had been doing it for probably 20 years prior to that. And so the Japanese found very quickly that you could not skin dive for abalone as a did in Japan because of the cold water here. So they imported the heavy gear helmet of the British design and improved it a little bit themselves. And as time went on, people like Kirby, Morgan, and others would modify the Japanese helmets, and without their having introduced them originally in 1898, it would have been very difficult for these advancements in diving to occur had not the Japanese introduced them in such a large way.
Now, the significance of the Japanese contributions to modern diving by bringing surface-applied diving to California, it cannot be overstated. The Japanese era of abalone diving came to an abrupt halt back in 1942 with the outbreak of World War II and their internment into camps by President Roosevelt. And this was 2.5 years. So the Japanese had dominated the abalone fishery diving. They had an excellent safety record, and that provided the opening for Caucasians to enter this industry. So the gear that you saw in the video was a copper helmet that they brought over from Tokyo, Japan, 1923. Had over 100 pounds of gear attached to it. The weight belt, the helmet itself, 17-pound shoes. Very cumbersome, but once you're in the water, the buoyancy of the helmet kind of offsets that weight. But very efficient for picking abalone off the seafloor. Ultimately, over time, 2/3 of all the abalone that were taken in California came from Santa Barbara due to its abundance out at the Channel Islands. Now, most of the abalone was processed out on Stearns Wharf back in the day, which was built in 1872 by John P. Stearns. Some of you old timers will probably remember abalone being processed out there on the wharf and shells being stacked up. I have several pictures of that, mounds of shells, the old shell mounds out in Goleta with the discarded abalone shells. So abalone was a big thing back in the 60s and 70s and 50s. The fishery has been closed locally since 1997, with the exception of free diving in Northern California, which was strictly regulated. Now it's even more strictly regulated. That fishery is on the brink of collapse. And recently, the California Fish and Game Department voted unanimously to close it for 2018 and quite possibly beyond. Now, what's all this fuss over abalone about, really? It's really delicious to eat, but the process for making the abalone, there we go. Okay, so they pry it off the rocks there with the abalone iron, and they take it up, it's in a shell, they gotta clean it, deshell it, it's quite messy, and then you slice it into 1/4-inch steaks and pound it out, bread it, fry it, lots of recipes around. I'm sure a lot of people here in Santa Barbara have their own way of making abalone, but it's actually quite good. It was once as abundant as hamburger was in local stores and restaurants. This is a menu from Cafe del Sol in Montecito, 1970. You can see a plate of abalone there is $5.50. Yeah, so it was actually pretty cheap. Move ahead to 2008. Yeah, so $50 a plate, that was in 2008, and now Cafe del Sol is closed, but you couldn't even get it if you wanted to, I'm sure. They're growing abalone now on these farms up north, and it's really scarce. Now, the evolution of abalone diving over time, the gear that they used back in the day, the heavy gear, was used during the 50s. They took over from the Japanese and used that heavy gear right up into the late 50s. There's a young lad Handelman. Did he show up yet? Anybody recognize that handsome face? Yeah. He was 17 years old at the time. I think that's how he got his nickname, Laddie. But he came from the Bronx, New York. And yes, he is a New York Giants fan, I'm told. Greg. But that gear that he used was very similar to what the Japanese used. And it was quite effective because they could just lean forward with the gear, pick their abalone, and they were pretty much everywhere in the 50s. Over time, though, those beds became scarcer. So they needed to cover more ground. And down in Newport Beach area, they had abalone divers as well. And there was a gentleman down there by the name of Bev Morgan who was working with full face masks and using a lightweight gear, as we call it today, using wetsuits and dry suits and things. That's an Aquala dry suit that diver has there. But they could cover more ground, and they actually needed to because the abalone were scarce. So this full face mask sits on the diver's face. They have the abalone catch bag there and the abalone iron, and they fill up the bag. They come back, dump it in a basket, haul it up, and they're in the water for hours and hours at a time, these guys. And then as we moved into the 1970s, you had everybody and their brother getting into abalone diving because it was quite a profitable vocation to be in. A lot of people are familiar with scuba, and this hookah gear evolved in the 70s, and it's actually still used today. And this is a standard scuba for you non-divers in the audience. This is standard scuba regulator. We stick it in our mouth, and we inhale on demand, and we get air. And they took this hose, rather than it going to a scuba tank, which is a limited gas supply, they would run this all the way up to the surface to an air compressor, and they'd have a tender, sometimes, on the boat, monitoring the air compressor, yeah. They did things different. But this was very effective. So you just needed a face mask, and that's actually a picture of Vladdy there years later. And you can see in the background there, the diver has a piece of hookah gear, scuba regulator, and they just went in with their wetsuit. And you could buy a wetsuit and a face mask and become an abalone diver, get your permit, and not have to invest in all this expensive heavy gear and lightweight surface supply gear. So hookah is actually still used today quite a bit. Now, what is significant for us to remember about this evolution of abalone diving here in Santa Barbara is these divers, they possessed three very important things. They were, firstly, not afraid to work in harsh environments. You can see the seas there, the pretty large swell in the background there, the Radden boat in the back. These guys are used to working in harsh environments. Cold water, the water is very cold out here. They were really resourceful in working with their boats, marine engines, compressors, fixing things. When you're out at San Miguel Island, you don't go running into the hardware store to get a part for your air compressor. You fix it out there on the job, baling wire and bubble gum. So these guys were good with that. Mike McCorkle knows that as a fisherman, this is what you got to do when you're at sea. Now, lastly, they understood that diving was just a means to get to a work site and make a profit, get a job done. So they had these three things. And they weren't exploited necessarily until later on, but every abalone diver possessed these three traits. Diving was not just something, hey, I'm looking cool. When you jump over the side, it doesn't matter. What matters is how many abalone you pick and how many you come back with. Now, around the turn of the century, when the Japanese were bringing the compressed air diving to the abalone fishery, Summerland was the site of the world's first offshore oil wells. Now, we know from the Chumash era that oil has existed here for thousands of years. And the oil companies, I don't think they were all that scientific about it. They said, hey, you know what? If oil is oozing up from the ground and the seafloor, let's drill here. Okay, so you see oil oozing up from the cliffs of Summerlin, they put these rigs in. So that's what it looked like back there from the Santa Barbara Historical Society around 1900. So the natural gas also bubbles up from the seafloor. Most of us know Coal Oil Point up by UCSB, you've got these natural seeps. And the gas and oil is bubbling up from the seafloor. And that soon led the oil companies from the cliffs of Summerland out into the offshore waters. Now, most people are not aware of this fact here, that the world's first offshore oil dive took place right off the Rincon. a gentleman by the name of Rigdon Crawford in 1929. And if you look at this slide closely here, you see in the lower right-hand corner, it's kind of cut off by the screen, there is a platform here, and it's actually on wooden pilings that are driven into the seafloor. But this was the world's first offshore oil rig, right off the Rincon, yeah. So these were the piers, and as they, you see them in the background there, they just said, hey, there's oil bubbling up out here, let's go out here. So they put the rig out there, and obviously the rig needed maintenance, so Rigdon went out and made a dive. Now, in 1929, he didn't use the Japanese heavy gear like they had. He used the US Navy Mark V gear. And if you look out front on your way out, where we take little donations into the Mark V helmet, you'll see that there. But that was around since 1915, that helmet. So interesting fact there. Now, right around the time in the 1950s, Associated Divers was the big ticket in Santa Barbara. They were the dominant company, the dominant force in early commercial diving. They formed in 1956. They were composed of primarily Southern California construction divers, and some of these abalone divers migrated into supporting the early offshore oil field work. They were highly paid, and rightly so, because they were diving deep. They were diving really, really deep. Interesting to note, the rig that you saw out there was just, you know, not even a half a mile offshore. And if you go out where the 5 mile rigs are out here, the continental shelf comes very close to Santa Barbara. So platform A and B, they're in like 260 feet of water. So the water gets deep very quickly out here. So these guys soon found themselves at Associated doing this oil field and construction work, going beyond 200 feet, breathing air and diving this heavy gear that I showed with the Laddie in the picture earlier. Now, those of you that are divers in the audience are probably saying, oh my God, that's well beyond 132 feet for scuba diving and nitrogen narcosis. They must have been like silly putty down there. Well, let me just take a second for you non-divers and explain what happens. When you go beyond, oh, about 132 feet or so, the nitrogen in the air is composed of oxygen and nitrogen. And the nitrogen component of the air, it's inert. We don't consume it. We consume the oxygen. But this nitrogen, you're breathing it right now. And you're not breathing it under high pressure. But the divers, when they go underwater, they're breathing compressed gas. So this nitrogen, when it's breathed under pressure, becomes narcotic, okay? So it affects the brain. It's kind of like going to Harry's and having a couple of cocktails and then saying, hey, let's make a dive, okay? It's literally the way it is. So these guys are going out to 200 feet, and the more they dove, and a lot of these guys developed a high tolerance, and they're very effective, don't get me wrong, at what they did. But they were diving beyond pushing the limits, okay? So in order for them to do a task, like, hey, you've got to go down and you've got to bolt up this flange, and they rehearse it topside, and they'd get everything down, what they got to do, I'm going to have a shackle sent down this time and that time. But if they had to change anything on the fly, well, hey, we need you to go over and inspect this, they'd be like, can't comprehend that. Okay, so essentially what happened during that time is the oil companies, they knew there were vast reserves well beyond 200, 250 feet, 300 feet. Murray Black was one of the divers who was diving up to 300 feet on air, if you can believe that. Anyway, they knew these vast reserves were out in 400 or 500 feet of water, and they wanted to get to them. Okay, and they couldn't because Associated is like, hey, we're done. We're at a standstill here. We're like silly putty down there. So the industry basically at that point, they wanted to move, but they couldn't because of diving. Now, the crux of the presentation, now, by the way, that's the late Ted Benton. Some of you may remember Ted. Ted and his brother Bob, long since passed away. But he was a famous Associated diver, very good diver. The crux of my presentation here centers around a key historical event that took place in November of 1962. A bold and risky dive was made by a Santa Barbara abalone diver by the name of Dan Wilson. And this is a display of his actual helmet that he used to make this dive.
He dove to 400 feet. He demonstrated that divers could work beyond 300 feet, and he dove to 400 feet, but he didn't dive breathing air. He used a different breathing mixture called oxy-helium, or heliox as it's called today. Back in the day, it was called oxy-helium. Now, he demonstrated that he could get there and do this dive, and the reason he did it was he knew that taking the nitrogen out and substituting in place with helium, the helium component of the breathing mixture is not narcotic, so you don't get this Harry's Plaza Cafe effect when you're down diving. So Danny learned about this down at the Sparling School of Deep Sea Diving down in Wilmington, where he was trained. And the Navy had been using oxyhelium since 1919. Professor Elihu Thompson experimented with it, and the Navy had been using it not very often, but they had done it successfully. They used it to salvage the Squalus back in the, I believe it was the 30s, a sunken submarine. Now, Danny did this dive, and he mixed up some heliox, and he went out, and he did this dive. November 1962, off the east end of Santa Cruz Island. It was made from the fishing boat Rio Janeiro, captained by local skipper Glenn Miller. Mike McCorkle, you remember Glenn, and you probably remember the boat. If you could get a picture of that boat, I'd love it. It was done in relative secrecy by Wilson and a small crew. He didn't want to draw attention from competing divers at Associated, even though a lot of them knew what he was up to. He went out, he had tarps on his boat when he left the harbor, had everything covered up, and he went out to the east end of Santa Cruz. He took his abalone diving helmet, this helmet right here, he took it over to Santa Barbara Radiator Shop because he needed to have some modifications done to it. And if you come up after we're done here tonight and look at this, you'll see in the back there's a, on the other side here, there's a little bubble that is soldered into the back of the helmet. And he took this second stage scuba regulator, not this exact one, but I actually have a Sportsways regulator, which was the original regulator he used. I found it on eBay. Put it inside the helmet. He took the second stage and he mounted it in the back, okay? And he took a mouthpiece and a tube from that regulator and ran it around front. You'll see it inside the helmet here. And he fed his hose with helium. He fed the umbilical with helium down, and he had a little valve on his on its control valve here where he could switch over to helium. So when it was time to go on gas, he would simply turn on the gas and he'd lean forward into his helmet and breathe on demand this helium. So he would have a demand free flow helmet, which was really the forerunner to what we use today. It was very ingenious, it was very crude, very simple, but it worked. So he made this dive November 3rd, 1962, off the east end of Santa Cruz. And he had safety divers. If you look at the display around back, there's some pictures. You'll see Dan down diving, making the dive, actual pictures from the dive. He had Brooks Photo Institute students as safety divers. So Ernie Brooks, he had an underwater photography program there. So he had a lot of divers. And Danny hired them to come out and be safety divers for this dive out at Santa Cruz. So they were waiting for him on his decompression stop when he got there. Interesting dive done by the seat of his pants on a fishing boat. All in-water decompression for you divers that are out there. We'll talk about that in a bit. But very interesting, and if you look at the picture on the back, just a little tidbit of information, you're gonna see one picture. For you divers in the audience, you've all seen the divers standing on the ladder. That's how they did it back in the day, and they took the helmet off, and they brought it up on deck, and then the diver climbed up on the ladder. Extremely dangerous to do, because if you fall in the water, your suit fills up with water and you drown. But that's what they did back then. Anyway, you'll see Dan in the picture, and you'll see his dress that he has on, the suit that he's wearing, and there's no breastplate on. And a lot of divers have asked me, why is he not wearing a breastplate? And Chris Swam, when he interviewed him, discovered why. Well, when he went down, the helmet is sealed with a little rubber gasket between the breastplate and the helmet. And at 400 feet, all that pressure forcing all this water into the gasket, and the gasket swelled up. When it came up, it expanded, and it created this wedge effect, so they could not get the helmet off. Yeah, so they had to actually unbolt the breastplate using their wrenches to get it off. I was told that, you'll see a picture in a little bit here, his wife Dorothy was on board the boat with him. And I have an awesome picture of her. I'll show you in just a second here. But he left the deck at 3 o'clock. He was back on board at 4:30, all in water decompression. So this dive really became what I call the catalyst for the evolution of underwater technology in Santa Barbara, as things rapidly evolved from that point forward. Now, my colleague, the late Bob Christensen, a good friend, many of you in the audience knew Bob. He's just a wonderful man, gentleman, and we actually have a memorial scholarship at City College in his honor, and it's an endowed scholarship. Dr. Beebe, president of City College, is here with us tonight, I don't know, Anthony, if you knew that we have that scholarship now endowed. We put it over the top for 20,000 investments, so it'll live in perpetuity. But I asked Bob, who was department chair at City College for a number of years, to summarize, because he was a player in that era, the significance of this evolution that took place in the 60s.
Heavy gear was king in 1960, 61, 62. That's what we dove, air heavy gear. Danny Wilson came along in the fall of 62, actually winter of 62, made a 400-foot helium oxygen dive using modified heavy gear, opened the eyes to a lot of people. The industry thought he was nuts, thought he was going to kill himself. The offshore oil thought, hey, we're going to get some bottom time and some deep water work out of this, and they almost immediately gave him a contract. He put together the gear, trained a few people very rudimentarily, and pulled off his contract. So then there was a scramble for everybody to get into mixed gas. Okay, well, mixed gas allows you to go deeper, stay longer, and breathe helium oxygen. Okay, that's a big chill factor. The heliox is very cold to breathe. The deep water is very cold. The decompression times are longer. Got to be a matter of exposure. Initially, we were doing surface dives on mixed gas down below 400 feet. That's just, today, that's ridiculous. You needed a way to get there and do the work and be protected. And so diving bells came along in about 64, the initial one. And the development of the diving bell was sort of a domino effect. You had to have gear that would fit in the bell. Heavy gear didn't work, so I had to go to lightweight gear. That started the development of some workable lightweight equipment. And that evolution has continued until today. We have very sophisticated bells and lightweight equipment.
There's Dorothy waiting on the Rio Janeiro. Anxiously waiting. You can see the cigarette in her hand there on the rail, smoking on a boat. And like I said, he had 126 minutes of in-water decompression, but as I said, it was the catalyst for this evolution and this rapid expansion, which is about to take place. Now, I asked Bob Kirby and Lad Handelman, did Lad show up yet? Maybe not. Is he here? Oh, good, he's here. Toot the horn. Yeah, okay. Well, anyway, thanks for coming, Laddie. I asked Bob Kirby and Lad Handelman to reflect on Wilson's dive, and along with his tender Jerry Roos, who I was able to interview. Jerry was from Bakersfield.
Diving had taken a change in a way. The old-time divers that were here were all working up to 250 feet on air. They always claimed that they could handle it because they were drunk to the point where they didn't get the bends like most people did, or else they didn't get stupid when they got under pressure. I think the case was that they were stupid all the time, and I think nothing would make any difference. Associated divers guys were getting the majority of the work. It was Danny Wilson, when he came along, he determined that if he could dive on helium, and he could make things go a lot better.
And he just wanted to show that we could do it. We didn't take much bottom time. He just wanted to show that we could get there and get up safe. And he had promised the oil companies that with his equipment, what we were doing, we could give them an hour's bottom time, which the air was only 25 minutes. Right. So that put us into the business because the oil company was happy.
Associated Divers didn't believe him. And so they made a few little statements like, I think it was Bob Rudy who said that, well, when Danny's through monkeying around and he's laying on the bottom dead, we'll go down and pick up his dead body and bring it back. Danny Wilson didn't like that.
So I seen how Dan Wilson had been out, seat of his pants, and jumped off the back of a fishing boat. With nothing much else but a fishing boat and his guts to show helium work to 400 feet. Not a commercial type operation, but he proved it could be done. And that made the difference.
The philosophy that those guys had was so much better than the philosophy at Associated Divers. Associated Divers was a bunch of union divers are always waiting to get their union pay and do their union work and actually, in many cases, make sure the job was stretched way out and they get a lot of time in the water. It was not the way to go, but that's what they did. When Laddy came along, Whitey, the name of the job was to get it done quickly and accurately and for less money.
It seems like we had planned. It took us 6 or 7 months before we were ever ready to make that dive. He knew what he was doing. He had to do it himself. That was the important thing. He wouldn't let Whitey or Danny or Laddie be in his thought at the beginning. That was his baby.
We would pretend that we were having little battles and so forth and spying on each other and laughing about each other. But when any one of the old team did something right and got someplace and was successful, we all cheered him under our breath. It was a philosophy of life that got us through and hard work.
Now, after this oxy-helium hit Santa Barbara, Associated Divers were dethroned locally, and they ultimately dissolved as a result of all the new competition that was rapidly taking place. Many of the players joined other companies that were coming online at that point, but all the divers in the area, they all knew each other, as Bob said. Okay, the Santa Barbara Helium Rush opened the deep water diving frontier for exploration beyond 300 feet. The big advantage to using oxyhelium over air for deep diving is that the helium is non-narcotic. The diver can perform a dive with a clear head and he can function much more efficiently. This was a huge advantage. And like all modes of diving, there are trade-offs between these risks and benefits. And one of those is the bends. Now, many people are curious about decompression sickness. It's an inherent risk for deep diving. When we dive using either air or helium, the inert component, either the nitrogen or the helium, we breathe it under pressure, and it's just along for the ride. We don't consume it metabolically, but it goes into solution in our tissues, in our blood, and ultimately dissolved in our tissues. That's all fine and good. And then when we come up, it wants to come out of solution. It wants to move from the tissues back to the blood and then back to the lungs where we exhale it and breathe it off in its dissolved state or gaseous form. Well, in a nutshell, if we come up too soon or too fast, these bubbles will form much the same as what happens with a bottle of soda water that I have right here. Now, you look at this, this is clear. There's gas dissolved in here, right? And it's under pressure. Now, if I release the top too quickly, you've all done this at home, right? What happens? bubbles form, right? So same thing with the diver. If they want to come up slow, release the pressure nice and slow. So you want to don't have the club soda go all over the place, you release the cap slowly, right? So same thing with diving. Sometimes we have to periodically stop in the water column to allow this gas, these molecules of gas, to move out and be breathed out. But if we come up too soon or too fast, we get the fizz coming out to the top of the bottle. Well, it's actually tonic water, it didn't fizz up that much. But you get the idea. Okay. Now, these bubbles, when they happen, they bad things happen. If they form in your circulation, usually they form in the veins because of the when you're diving, it moves from the tissues back to the veins. But if you get bubbles in your blood, your body says, hey, this is bad. Attack it with antibodies. And it basically, your blood sludges up. It gets very thick. And bad things happen. You get ischemic. Things swell up. You can have these bubbles press against nerve endings, spinal cord, in your brain. It can kill you. It can paralyze you. So we really want to avoid this decompression sickness. It's an inherent risk, and we always have to deal with it. So the gas divers of the day, they had to contend with this as well. I need a volunteer for my next little demonstration here. Do I have a volunteer? One of the other drawbacks of the helium is you get cold really quickly. By breathing this stuff, it wicks the heat away from your body some 6 times faster. Jill Laney, what I have here is some oxy-helium in here. And this is a little regulator. And what I want you to do is I want you to seal this up against your face, like that, and breathe. Now you're gonna get cold after a few minutes here. So 6 times faster, it wicks the heat away from your body. And as you're diving, the divers got really cold and they hated this helium because they get so chilled very quickly. You getting cold, Joe? A little bit? Well, hang on, just keep breathing, keep breathing. You'll be okay.
He's got some ice.
Can you read that slide for me, Joe? Take the mask away. Read the slide. Read it.
I can't.
You can't?
I can't.
You can't?
I can't.
Follow the yellow brick road. Follow the yellow brick road.
Follow the yellow brick road.
Take another hit.
Deep
one. Okay, now read it.
Follow the yellow brick road.
Ah, it's pretty good. Yeah. With the British accent, it's great. It's marvelous. Jill Laney, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Okay, so back to it. The voice change in the helium was a real problem that they had to contend with as well. Not only did you have the chill effect, which is very real, you had to contend with the understanding of the diver. So they had to develop these helium radios. Whoop, excuse me. These radios that they developed were called helium unscramblers. And they basically attenuated the signal coming into the radio so that you could basically understand. Still sound like Donald Duck. But we had to develop that equipment. Now, oxygen is another component that is very hazardous for divers. And we normally associate oxygen as a good thing. And it really is. But we're diving under pressure now. Just like with the nitrogen and the helium, under high pressures, bad things can happen. They respond differently. Oxygen is actually toxic at high pressures. And the oxygen, we're breathing 21% here right now in air, but when we go deep diving with it, we actually have to take some of the oxygen out. Normally it's 21% in air, but when we go mixed gas diving, we have to take some out and reduce the percentage, because when we go diving, we breathe more molecules and we can live. But if we get too much of this in our breathing mixture, it messes with our brain, okay, in a nutshell. Things short circuit. And one of the early symptoms is convulsive seizures. And if this happens to a diver underwater, very feared condition that the gas divers had to contend with, it's usually not survivable. January 31st, 1964, Dan Wilson was out off our coast, right out here at 250 feet on oxy-helium, when he had a seizure and he went unconscious due to this feared oxygen toxicity. Now, the standby diver on the job that day was Whitey Steffens, who's passed away several years ago, one of the most respected divers in Santa Barbara, if not the industry. His name is on the Hall of Fame trophy over here, Commercial Diving Hall of Fame trophy, as is Laddie Handelman's, and my colleague Mike von Alvensleben is on there. There's about 9 Santa Barbara divers on that trophy up there. Anyway, Whitey was down, he was the standby diver, and like Danny, he was trained at Spalding School of Deep Sea Diving down south. He knew he had to jump into action, he knew exactly what to do. Whitey lived above me here on the Mesa, and I had the opportunity to interview him about this dive. And I really treasured this interview because, as I said, Whitey's no longer with us, but I had heard this story of this rescue when I was in dive school, except it had been convoluted and they substituted, oh, it was my boss and my buddy did this and that, and all BS. Chris Swan had it documented correctly, but I decided to interview Whitey about this dive.
Well, I was standby diver when he was down, so I was already dressed in. Fine, going down to hit bottom, and he was talking all right, and then pretty soon he wasn't talking. We had no communication. I jumped in and went down his hose as a descending line, because that's going to take me right to him. When I got him, he was laying over on the bottom, and just dark blue in the face port, and I knew he was pretty well out, so I immediately put him on some open circuit to flush the helmet out, set the two valves, his exhaust valve as well as his air coming in. Then I got him up to his first stop. He's still out, but he's opening and blinking his eyes, but the color is coming back a little bit. And then I had him bring him up to the next stop, and I'm right there beside him. Got into the next stop. He was on that for about, I don't think more than 3 or 4 minutes. You ever see a guy go crazy? Neither did I. But I'm not a weakling. I couldn't hold him. Oh, his face, his eyes got that big, and he started climbing. He was going to the surface. Yeah, I tried to stop him, but I couldn't. I figured he was dead. The guys had him up at the water and he's out, and they're trying to pick him up and they can't quite do it. And Mitch, he went down that ladder and he grabbed Danny and got him over his shoulder. Hang on, he just came up that ladder just like nothing, I'm told, because I was down there yet.
You're so decompressing, huh?
Yeah. So they got him up in the water, and Laddie was in the tank decompression from a previous dive. So he was in the back chamber, and he had the front one open so they can get him in. I also had Lionel Weaver, our medical guy, I had him come out. Before I went to water, I said, get hold of Lionel Weaver and get him out here in a chopper, which they did, because I didn't know exactly what we were going to do. At any rate, he came out fine.
You saved his life.
Well, maybe I didn't. I did get him off of the bottom and get him up. The guys on the top saved his life. They got him into that chamber, just rip, shit, or bust.
Yeah, that's what I really call a heroic dive. Had not Whitey and General Offshore responded the way that they did, the crew, our industry would have likely taken a really different turn. Mixed gas diving probably would have been shut down here in California. Now, investigation into the to the incident soon revealed the problem. They had thought that they were diving 18% oxygen in the mixture. And when they analyzed the gas, they found out that they had 20% in the mixture. Now, that's only 2% difference. On the surface, that's not going to affect us, but at 264 feet, it was enough to put him over the edge and give him the seizure. Now, that experience had a profound impact on Dan Wilson. He never did any gas diving after that. He was actually too busy with contracts and working with General Offshore, but he never dove gas again after that. He was really focusing on other things, expanding his business, building the Prisma Diving Bell, et cetera. This is a shot of the Prisma Diving Bell back in the day. You can see it there. You've all seen it out front when you come walking in, the big orange bell outside there. And I do want to acknowledge, I know Ted Roach is here tonight. Ted, where are you at? I can't see where the light, there he is. And that bell we bought over from Florida. From when Dan passed away, he had this thing in storage in a boatyard in Florida. And I had heard about it from his son. And the boatyard had, Dan didn't pay his bills. And the boatyard was ready to sell it for scrap. So this is the world's first commercial diving bell. And it's a historic piece. And we were able to get that bell back here to Santa Barbara. And thanks to Ted Roach for DiveCon, his company, provided the trucking services to get that bell from Florida here to Santa Barbara. And at City College, we retrofit this with the students and moved it over here to the museum with the help of Mr. Seth Hammond, who is here tonight from Specialty Crane. Seth, where are you at? Oh, yeah. Seth is... He's helped us countless times over the years, and he moved that bell probably no fewer than 5 times off the truck, a little left, a little right, when we needed to turn sideways to take the frame off, et cetera. But thank you, Seth and Ted, for your efforts in getting that bell here to Santa Barbara, and this is where it's going to stay, right where it was launched a few years ago. So back to our talk here. The helium rush of the 60s was the catalyst for 3 significant things in the evolution of underwater technology. Firstly, we needed new equipment. We needed these helium unscramblers. We needed mixed gas diving manifolds. We needed diving bells. We needed lightweight diving gear, swim gear to use from the bells. The second thing that happened, you had everybody that was in the area. It wasn't just Dan and Laddie and Whitey doing it. You had Woody Treen and you had Murray Black and you had all these other divers that, hey, we're going to get some of this mixed gas diving work too. So they got into the act. So you had competing local companies. It's the way that our country works. We have competition, free market society. So you had these competing local companies quickly emerge using helium for deep diving. And then the third thing is, you had this massive worldwide labor demand for all the new deep oil exploration work and diving work, which could now take place. So it quickly went from Santa Barbara overseas to the Gulf of Mexico, Libya, North Sea years later. They were using heliox to dive deep. All started here in Santa Barbara. So soon you had these copper collar abalone divers who soon became white collar businessmen in the spirit of entrepreneurism that spread throughout Santa Barbara and the world. So we had this new market driven underwater economy, and it was really a fantastic period. One of those copper collar abalone divers is sitting over here, my good friend Lad Handelman. Now, like others in the 1960s, talking about equipment, Bob Kirby and Bev Morgan, they were also abalone divers who transitioned into commercial oil field diving. Now, Kirby worked for Associated, and he designed a cost-effective helium helmet that helped to compete against this thing here in the Santa Barbara helium rush. So Bob's helmet is on display in one of the cases over there, and rather than exhausting this expensive helium into the water column, Kirby invented a technique where we could recirculate the helium around and breathe it over and use it over again. So the free flow heavy gear helmet came up with a recirculator using a Venturi principle to get the gas back. That gas was expensive, about 35 cents a breath is what it costs. So you want to get your use out of it and use it over. So Kirby had engineered that, and him and Bev partnered in 1965. Now Bev, prior to coming up to Santa Barbara, he was a diver down in Newport Beach area, and he was building these full face masks and doing some fiberglass work. He was ultimately hired along with Bob Ratcliffe and Bob Christensen to work on developing lighter weight swim gear, as they called it back in the day. We now call it lightweight gear. You'll see in the cases, they're now covered up because Emily's working on the cases back there, but these helmets that you'll see are called lightweight gear. And they were needed to work out of the Purisma diving bell. Now, if you look at the Purisma diving bell, well, not that you're gonna climb up on top, but the reason this gear didn't work in the diving bell, when Wilson designed the diving bell, he made the hatch too small. So he couldn't get in with his helmet and broad shoulders, so he had a little hatch about 18 inches in diameter. And now we have much bigger hatches. But he had to contend with that. So this lightweight gear that Morgan was using, he hired Bev and like I said, Bob Christensen and Bob Ratcliffe to build these rigid frame abalone masks to use out of the bells with the Koala dry suits. So Bob and Bev formed this partnership out here on the breakwater. They met and I guess they had a cup of coffee and it evolved into the Kirby Morgan Dive Systems in 1965.
I started making the helium helmets about the time that I met Bev Morgan. And so we went to work together, and after 1 month, we determined that we were both compatible in the shop. I don't know that I ever could have run into somebody that was more knowledgeable than Bev Morgan, easier to get along with. Every day we would come across new ideas and new ways of doing things, innovative things that would just blow your mind away.
And Kirby and I, you're talking about the climate in the shop in those days. Every other day we had somebody calling us up to buy us out.
I don't think we could have pulled it off if we weren't divers. It's easier to train ourselves to mold the fiberglass and get Dick Quinton to do the machine work than it was to learn how to be divers.
And having a kind of a sense of what divers want and how to improve things, it's a constant improving situation. Well, we're up to number 77 in design now on helmets. Well, 77 in 40 years means a couple of improvements every year. We're still using the same gear that we used 40 years ago, that Kirby and I sat down and built 40 years ago and replaced the heavy gear. 40 years. That gear is going to be used 50 years from now.
We lost Bev this summer in June. He passed away, and the end of an era, basically. The name Kirby Morgan, though, it's a household word in commercial diving. In essence, they're the Microsoft of the diving industry. They put this town on the map as the worldwide leaders of commercial diving equipment. All the navies overseas and that, God knows how many helmets they've made. They used to be over on Garden Street, 425 Garden Street. You'll still see a sign up over there. They moved to a huge manufacturing plant up in Santa Maria now.
Well, I was living in Newport Beach and abalone diving for a living. I was already building masks and helmets down there. And what I really wanted to do is build a headpiece for the diver, be it a helmet or a mask or whatever. Danny got going up here and made his 400-foot dive, then started his company. I was up here abalone diving off and on, and I would meet with him now and then or see him at the harbor, and we'd chat it up. And so I made the decision that I'd just move up here and work for Danny. Danny was really a forward-thinking guy, and One of the reasons was he wasn't a trained businessman. He was a diver and an innovative diver. And he couldn't innovate too much on the abalone, but he sure could on gas diving and stuff. Gas diving was old hat for the military, but not for civilians. So Danny just went right in there and started diving gas.
Well, Dan's dive, when was that? November 62. I was working for Associated basically at that time, and when Dan made that dive, the consensus among the old-time divers was, he's nuts, he's going to kill himself, and he's lucky he didn't. But that changed the whole atmosphere, the whole diving atmosphere, to bring gas in, more bottom times, clear-headed, able to work deeper. It just changed the diving environment totally.
Well, it changed diving completely, commercial diving, and introducing the gas thing. And then at the same time, the Navy was working with their saturation diving program. Danny came up with the deal of mating a single lock bell onto a deck chamber complex. That was the next step, and the Navy was behind on things like that.
And of course, you start going deeper, you need diver protection. The bell was for diver protection, and that introduced a new era, a new concept. So yes, things just evolved into bells, lightweight gear, all one necessitated the advent of the next, until now. It's pretty much all diving bells, either open bottom or closed bell, and lightweight gear, hot water wetsuits. That's vogue now.
Well, here we are, you know, in our 80s, you know, laughing and giggling still, so I guess that's all good. So it's really interesting how everything turned out, and it pretty much all started in Santa Barbara, because that was where the abalone were at a certain point in the abalone industry, and now all that's gone, and probably just as well, but commercial diving goes on.
Then he was a forward-thinking individual. The concept, from my point of view and many, was that he was out of his mind.
He created the environment for anyone interested in any aspect of commercial diving to get involved. And yeah, he drew in a lot of people, like Del Tomlinson was a ex-Navy master diver, and you could make a living here in Santa Barbara with diving abilities or skills or knowledge. And he created that center, and City College was part of it. And just look at all the graduates of City College that have gone out into the world and done things. You know, it's pretty amazing that there's still a center here. Anyway, the guy was, he did a lot of good things, and in spite of the fact that I knew his weaknesses, so to speak, or knew how to get to him and fooled with him, I think, God, who knows? The guys were probably running around pulling tricks on General Grant in the Civil War, you know, and laughing in the background. But he got the job done, and so did Danny.
Two local companies of interest that emerged from that era were CalDive and Oceaneering. It eventually evolved into Oceaneering. General Offshore was soon bought out by Union Carbide, and the three partners, Ken Alms and Whitey and Laddie, and were four partners, and Danny, they went their separate ways. Laddie went off and started CalDive, which had its offices out on Stearns Wharf for a period of time. Danny went down to the Gulf of Mexico, ultimately, and started Subsea International, another company, which many of our graduates at City College went to work for. Whitey stayed here in Santa Barbara and managed Solis Ocean Systems for many years. Now, Cal Dive was out on the wharf, as I mentioned, and later, Laddie and two other individuals partnered and formed a company called Oceaneering International. And it's very significant because Oceaneering today is probably one of the world's, if not the world's, most profitable and very big underwater intervention company. They started out doing saturation diving and things, which you'll see in the video. But they're publicly traded on the New York Stock Exchange. And these are just but a handful of companies that emerged here locally. But Oceaneering is still around down in Houston, Texas. They had their corporate offices over on Coda Street for a while, right across from Mom's, I believe it is, where Mom's used to be, right over there by Arnaldi's. Oceaneering, publicly traded, big company.
Santa Barbara's Lad Handelman co-founded Oceaneering International in 1969 by merging his company CalDive with two others. Their signature dive helmet was the Rat Hat, built by Bob Ratcliffe, another Santa Barbara abalone diver who also worked with General Offshore. Oceaneering brought access to deeper diving depths with their atmospheric diving suits. UCSB scientists Alice Aldridge and Bruce Robeson used the WASP in 1982. The WASP and gym suits allowed divers to work at depths over 2,000 feet without exposure to the elements or decompression. The arms bell featured a state-of-the-art manipulator system perfected by Scott Millard, another local who later formed Western Space and Marine. The electrohydraulic arm was controlled by an operator inside the bell with a master controller. The slaved arm would mimic the motions of the operator and had a high degree of dexterity.
So Oceaneering's atmospheric diving division, they really expanded the deep frontier for diving well beyond the range of man diving. We have limitations as far as how deep man can go, but they push exploration beyond those physiological limits because of these atmospheric diving suits. So suddenly we could go past 2,000 feet without exposure to the elements or any decompression. So no oxygen toxicity, narcosis, any of that stuff. No colds. You could, you know, dive. I dove atmospheric diving suits for several years before I got into teaching, and you could go in your street clothes and stay quite warm. It was safe, it was efficient, and it immediately became an alternative to the expensive saturation diving, which was taking place with diving bells at the time. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the mid-1960s projected needs for labor, future divers, the projections exceeded 5,000. Now, at the time, there were fewer than 150 nationwide. So you had numerous local divers and community members here in Santa Barbara. They were instrumental in establishing ways to meet those needs. A world-class program was created over here across the street at Santa Barbara City College, where I work. We're now celebrating our 50th anniversary this year. The motto when the program was created was more than just a diver. Rarely does a day go by that I am not reminded of how this program has positively impacted so many lives.
In 1968, the late Ramsey Parks established the Marine Technology Program at Santa Barbara City College. The initial facility was on Nopal Street. Abby Treen reflects on her husband Woody's involvement.
Sid Frank was my my boss's name, and he asked me one day, he said, I need to talk to Woody because we want to start some kind of a vocational training program. So anyway, they got their heads together, and Woody wanted to make really positive that this program from the City College didn't give just an overview of training, that it gave in-depth training so that when the students went out and went to look for a job, they were safe, they knew what they were supposed to do, and they would have a good occupation. And he was so adamant about that. I get goosebumps thinking about it. because he said, I don't want it to, what's a crash course? He said, I want it to be a good program. I think that it turned out to be exactly that.
That's the first graduating class from City College. That was taken at the old timbers out in Goleta, that picture. Yeah, you may remember that. I think it turned out to be exactly that too, Evie. I look at Wilson, as you mentioned before, he was a catalyst for worldwide deep water gas diving because he thought outside the box, as Bob mentioned. If he did not do what he did, somebody else would have. Because the demand to explore deeper depths at the time was really ubiquitous here in Santa Barbara. Somebody else, one of the other players, would have done it. He was in the right place at the right time and took some risks, and they paid off. So we had this need for specially trained people, equipment. It was market-driven, created a thriving local economy, which in many cases still exists, not quite as thriving as it was back in the day. I went to Wilson's memorial service, which was another inspiration for me to put together this talk years ago, because Laddie invited me. It was over at Santa Barbara Yacht Club, and I was taken aback at how many individuals in Santa Barbara there were paying tribute to this man and how many people he influenced. They poked a lot of fun at him, but I started to really think, wow, these are people here in this room that I have read about in my history books while I was in dive school talking about another individual. And I thought that was pretty profound. There's a young Bob Ratcliffe. Is Bob here tonight? Are you here, Mr. Ratcliffe? There he is. He was a good looking guy back then, wasn't he? Man. So, historically speaking, yeah, Danny was an entrepreneur. He dreamed big, but he acted on his dreams. He was surrounded by good people, and he had a huge pool, as I mentioned earlier, of experienced technicians and talented abalone divers. He drew upon those talents, and he was inspiring to an awful lot of them. I love this quote by Laddie. He told me many years ago that all things diving trace back to the abalone, and now I totally understand. But Laddie remains the preeminent icon for modern commercial diving today. He's a huge supporter of the Santa Barbara community, lots of nonprofits here in town, and this museum. He's also on the Hall of Fame trophy over there, as I mentioned. But I asked Laddie and Whitey to reflect on that Wilson era, and I pulled these clips from the interview that I did with Whitey, and I haven't shown these before.
But you can do any damn thing you want to do if you put your mind to it, and he sure as hell had his mind put to it. And he was very fortunate to get some good people working with him, me being one.
Dan Wilson and Whitey Stephens were both very hard, much hardheads, who love the answers and quite often get into almost physical blows with each other about stuff.
When I got down there, I used a lot of profanity if I didn't get what I wanted.
Ken Elms was the father of the whole deal. He brought common sense and business sense to the whole operation. My job is like a kid between two warring parents, trying to find a way to keep them from killing each other, but doing it in a way that I wouldn't be obvious doing so.
Kenny Elms was our partner. That's where the general transport came in. We were general offshore divers. He was general offshore transport. We sat in Kenny Elms' office, and the idea to start the company, we needed some money. So I put $10,000 in, Laddie put $10,000 in, Kenny Elms put $10,000 in. And then he put Danny's $10,000 in because Danny didn't have it. whatever Danny made, I mean, he lived fast and whatever he had, he spent. but he made a fortune.
But each one of those guys had major ideas on how to do things, and which forged a great successful combination. And I learned from both of them.
But like I said, it was his idea, and we had a lot of hell of a lot of fun. He inspired the hell out of Laddie, because Laddie turned around and did the same thing. And it's still going, what Laddie started, and it's still going, what Dan started. You still have subsea in the Gulf.
Santa Barbara is connected to the diving industry because of the unique environment that we have here, particularly with the islands. You know, you talk about the history of the offshore industry. It really started with the abalone divers and the guys that were diving here for abalone back in the 50s and the 60s. And that became a very big deal. And that was the breeding grounds for everybody that went off into the offshore industry as far as commercial oil field diving goes today.
I think when you look at a maritime town like Santa Barbara, an active port, and you look at how it's connected to the rest of the world, the most significant contribution this town has made when you glean through all the different historical aspects is the presentation of deep water diving technology and the manufacture of the equipment that allows divers anywhere in the world to do that sort of diving is the most significant historical fact of the town.
Dan Wilson saw an opportunity out here because the diving was all done on air, which was not efficient, and he opened the door. He said, here's an opportunity. I'll find a reasonable, practical way to dive with helium, and he did it. And that was the beginning of helium diving in the commercial world. He also took the next step, which was to develop the first commercial lockout diving bell. You can say, well, someone would have done both of those things, quite true, but he was the first.
Diving technology in Santa Barbara is a critical part of the maritime history. We are so fortunate to have so many of those diving great individuals here locally. And yes, they do walk through our doors daily, and it's really very exciting to be in such a rich community that way.
Divers, because of the nature of the business, obviously they work out of sight of the public. And so in a way, has been somewhat of a, should we say that profession has not been acknowledged maybe as much as it should have been, but it certainly is very important.
Santa Barbara has such a rich diving community. I mean, you have commercial divers, you have scientific divers, you have underwater photographers like Mike DeGree, you have inventors like Bob Evans and Bev Morgan. So you have a tremendously diverse community of people who are involved with the ocean. Really, probably more than any other city that I know of in the United States, if not the world.
When you look at the last century, when you look at the home of commercial diving, you look to Santa Barbara.